It came to pass that King Arthur would hold a grand tournament in Winchester, and all the knights would attend, all save Sir Lancelot, who would stay behind with Guinevere as her sworn protector. But as King Arthur and his fellow knights darted across the green misted landscape of England, Lancelot and Guinevere mused. They decided it would be a wonderful idea for Lancelot to attend the tournament in disguise, to see how his fellow knights truly performed in his absence. So he donned the armor of an older, mysterious knight, and he made his way north to the tournament. Well, on his way to the tournament, he happened to stay at the Lord of Shallot's manor home near Winchester. There was a grand feast taking place. The red braziers burned their luminant light upon the dull gray walls of the castle. They brought out wine and cakes and the seasoned head of a boar. Oh, there was music and dancing, and Lancelot's heart was filled with warmth and light and camaraderie in this blessed house on the moorlands. And then she entered. The beautiful young Lady of Shallot, her lips as red as a ruby rose, her cheeks as white as the winter snow, and her eyes as blue as the moorland sky. She was the Lord of Shalott's only daughter, and as her eyes fell upon Lancelot and his upon hers, tears welled up within her. Crying, sobbing, she fled back to her room, slamming the door behind her. Lancelot was beside himself. He ran after the girl, and he called through the door, "Lady, I am simply a wandering knight. I meant you no offense. Tell me what it is I have done to offend you, and I will gladly atone for this misdeed." "Good Sir Knight," she called back, "you have done nothing, but it appears I have fallen in love with you upon first sight, and I know not how to contain these emotions." Lancelot was confused. At this time in our epic, he was already in love with Guinevere. But here was a young girl who loved him terribly. He decided to try to compromise. "Milady," he said, "I will be completely honest with you. I'm in love with another woman, but I will gladly represent you in the tournament tomorrow if it is of any consolation to you." The door opened, tears streaming down her cheeks. She held up a blue silk scarf and said, "Good Sir Knight, take this, my blue silk scarf, hang it upon your shield, and win this tournament for me. It would mean so much." Lancelot took her hand in his, brushed away her tears, kissed her upon the cheek, and he made his way to the tournament. Tournament it was. King Arthur and his fellow knights assembled, their silver armor gleaming in the sunlight. Lances clashed upon shields, and swords sparked in the summer light. Well, in the end, it was Lancelot who was victorious, but not without suffering a grievous head wound. He fled the battlefield, lest King Arthur's healers discover his true identity, and he made his way back to the Lady of Shallot, where her healing skills brought him back to health much faster than would have otherwise. And during their time together, she fell more and more deeply in love with Lancelot, and Lancelot, in turn, yearned for Guinevere. But as we should all come to realize, we don't always choose who falls in love with us, nor do we always get to choose with whom we fall in love. Weeks passed, and one day Lancelot took her hand in his. He brushed away her tears, kissed her upon the cheek, and made his way back to Camelot. He left, and it was as if the world had melted away, revealing only angst and despair for the beautiful young Lady of Shallot. She had found her true love, but he was in love with another. Summer turned to autumn, and the trees changed. They dressed themselves in garnets and golds and russets and oranges. Her health changed, too. She grew ill. One autumn evening, she stood on the balcony of her manor home. She looked up to the moon and to the stars, and she sang this lonesome song into the night wind. I see your eyes in star-strewn skies, your smile in the moon. Still I cannot find you here, my love, my love. Mon ami, mi amor. Oh, my Lancelot, I love you. He never came. And as autumn turned to winter, and a soft blanket of whiteness covered the land, her health grew worse. She was dying, slowly, of a broken heart. In the end, it was all she could do but to board a small boat, point it towards Camelot, and let the frigid currents of fate take her where she needed to be. Meanwhile, in Camelot, King Arthur stood proudly upon the parapets of his castle. His breath shone misted in the gray winter sky. He surveyed his lands. Below him stretched his endless forests. Well, the leaves had fallen from the branches, and a thin crystalline ice clung to them like glass fingers. And as he gazed through this menagerie, he noticed a gold-awninged boat drifting aimlessly towards Camelot. Well, he rushed down to the frost-mudded banks to find the boat lodged in the shore, and he peeled back the gold awning to reveal the body of the Lady of Shallot. On her person was a note addressed to King Arthur and all the knights of Camelot, stating that it was Lancelot, being the most beautiful and courageous of men, but also the most cruel and inflexible, who had caused the death of this wretched maiden. King Arthur was moved. He ordered a funeral for the young girl with the highest honors of her rank and station. And as the citizens of Camelot gathered around the funeral pyre, a lone bard, lute in hand, stepped from the crowd and sang this song into the twilight.
On the tower and balcony, by garden wall and greenery, a gleaming shape she floated by. A course between the houses high, silent into Camelot. Out upon the wharf they came, knight and burgher, lord and dame, and round the prow they read her name, the Lady of Shallot. And what is here? And in the lighted palace near died the sound sounds of royal cheer as they cross themselves in fear. All the knights of Camelot, but Lancelot mused a little space and said, "She has a lovely face. God in his mercy lend her grace, the Lady of Shallot."
And as the flames of the funeral pyre roared into the heavens, and her ashes mingled with the sky and with the earth, they could see her silvery spirit floating above them. She looked up to the moon and to the stars, and back down to Lancelot. She smiled a sad but sweet smile, and sang this lonesome song into the night wind one last time.
"I see your eyes in star-strewn skies, your smile in the moon. Still I cannot find you here.